Oh boy, so much to catch up. Falcon 9, H-IIA and Atlas V launch, now on KNews. Hey guys, Lucas here. Welcome to KNews for weeks 8 and 9 2018. And as always, a big shout out to you my KNews boosters, who support this little show financially. Thanks for your trust. But before I talk about rockets flying to orbit, let me quickly mention a rather silly suborbital launch. It happened just yesterday, so it does not exactly fit into this episode, but I lolled hard and I just have to mention it. Mad Mike Hughes, a concerned US stuntman who questions his science education in school, launched himself on top a DIY steam-powered rocket. The flight took only a few seconds and launched him approximately 100 meters up. The parachute landing afterwards was quite hard, but according to my Twitter feed, the lucky man is still alive. His goal with these launches is to raise more public interest, to get more sponsors, to fund his dream of a real spaceflight. A spaceflight is the only way for him to prove whether the Earth is really a sphere or not. He wants to see it with his own eyes, basically. Anyways, now to more serious things. Falcon 9 was first to launch on February 22nd from Vandenberg on the US West Coast. Yep, there was another unknown fuming object in the evening sky over California. Up top were three satellites, with the main one being an Earth observation satellite for the Spanish military called PAZ, which means peace, and two communication satellites for SpaceX themselves called Tintin A and B. I'm not sure if there is a definitive answer about the name's origin yet, but all articles I've read so far relate to the French comic character Tintin. It's very famous in Europe, however, I'm a little skeptical about that, since the satellites are called Tintin A and B, while there is only one Tintin. Another explanation would be the Latin word tintinnabulum, which means bell. Derived from that is the English word tintinnabulation, which was first used in poetry by the famous Edgar Allan Poe. Tintinnabulation refers to the ringing sound of a bell after it was struck. It would make kind of sense since a bell rings at its resonance frequency and so does a communication device. However, whether this is really the name's origin or not remains unknown, at least for me, so please feel free to tell me what you know and think about it. Anyhow, Falcon 9 launched for the last time using an old Block 3 booster, which was not recovered. Launching from Vandenberg, the destination was as usual a polar orbit, hence the rocket flew towards the South Pole. As the rocket goes through its mission in the background, let me give you some more details about SpaceX's future satellite constellation. As you probably know, SpaceX wants to build a huge satellite constellation named Starlink, which will consist of over 9,000 satellites in low Earth orbit. Tintin A and B are not final and are just meant to test some of their technologies. As Elon Musk said on Twitter, there are still some milestones to achieve before they can begin setting up their communication network. However, I want to tackle some confusion which was partly introduced by Elon Musk himself, calling it Wi-Fi. You will not be able to connect to a Starlink Wi-Fi network with your mobile device that easily. While theoretically possible, you will instead have to use a big antenna that you can, for example, mount on your house's roof or maybe even a car. This so-called user terminal will then create its own Wi-Fi you can connect devices with. I just wanted to clarify that this will not directly compete with your local 4G or 5G networks. It will instead supplement it in areas which are just too remote for other technologies. I personally look forward to it because it means internet will finally become a global phenomenon. No matter where you live or travel to, even at sea, all you need is an unfoldable antenna and a solar panel or battery to access high-speed internet without having to worry about regional limitations. The big question that remains for me is how SpaceX will monetize on this. Will they personally collect monthly fees from people all around the world, which would be an organizational mess, or will they sell their own user terminals that could ship with a bundled free lifetime access? Do you maybe know more about this, or have you a better idea? If so, tell me about it in the comments. Anyways, since I'm playing catch up with my schedule, let's move to the next two launches, from which one happened on February 27th. It was a Japanese H-IIA that took off from Tanegashima. On top was IGS Optical 6, where IGS stands for Information Gathering Satellite. As the name suggests, it is a spy satellite and belongs to a whole constellation which was Japan's answer to the North Korean missile program, who began to launch rockets over Japan 20 years ago. So it is everything but a new phenomenon. And the last rocket I want to cover in this episode is the Atlas V that launched on March 1st from Cape Canaveral. The payload was GOES-17, or Geostationary Operational Environmental Satellite. The satellite will be placed over America at 137 degrees west and observe the continent with different imagers. The main one can capture 16 different frequency bands of light. This means it can take detailed grayscale images of 16 different colors, ranging from visible red and blue to mostly invisible infrared. This is useful because different elements in the atmosphere reflect different portions of light. Having many individual bands, which each records different elements, now allows scientists to analyze the gas movement within the atmosphere. Stacking multiple ones together in false color leads to images like this. Pretty cool actually, but I have no idea what exactly we are looking at. I will link the websites where you can access recent images in the description. Okay, that shall conclude this episode, and I hope to see you next one if you like. Auf Wiedersehen and thank you for watching.